Welcome to Trill Life Ministries. In our presentation this afternoon, the Brotherhood brings you a video encapsulation of a message that's inspired by the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord.
This afternoon, we just want to try to bring an informal presentation here as the Spirit moves. And the subject that we're going to be covering today is the open windows of heaven. And I'm inviting you to think, if you might, on the aspects of living under the open windows of heaven. Is there such an entity as the open windows of heaven? Or is it just for granted that we take God's blessings? Now, in sharing this message to you, the scripture that comes to mind primarily at first is that from Malachi. Read that, and I invite you to turn to Malachi. This is a very well-known scripture, chapter 3. And it's going to be verse 10. Everybody is familiar with this scripture, but it is good that your eyes should see this and that your mind should meditate upon it. And we just start from verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? And his answer is, in tithes and offerings. Ye are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. God goes on to invite you to say, there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. Verse of scripture. The Lord here is, it seems, challenging you to prove it. And he's telling you how you can prove him. And he's telling you that you can bring the tithes and the offerings into the storehouse and prove him if he will not open these windows of heaven and pour you out blessings, that there will not be room enough to receive it. Certainly in my household, God has done just that. Just recently, my wife and I, we were saying, one of our major concerns in purchasing things for the home is where we're going to put it. Go, Mommy. We have a shed in the backyard, which we got to benefit some people who were staying with us. And today that shed is filled with articles. Don't ask me where they came from, but just bit by bit, parcel by parcel, piece by piece, the shed is full. We have another shed, and that's full. And our home is, we have to treat it very circumspectly in terms of what we acquire, because there's always the consideration of where we're going to put this. And oftentimes there are things in a house that we have to think of where we're going to move these, where we're going to file these. This one's going in the attic. We're not using the baby swing right now. And certainly there are things that we still desire. There are things that we still want. And as we keep the Spirit of the Lord in mind and are led by His Spirit, then we know we will go from strength to strength. But I want to look, if you will, to capture, if you will, this great moment, this great aspect where God causing us to prove Him. I like to think of people living under an open heaven. Certainly Avazzini states that people who don't tithe and make offerings live under a closed heaven. And I rather think that is very, very true. The Lord here invites you to prove Him in your tithes and your offerings if He will not open the windows of heaven. I'm not an authority to say at this point that the Lord doesn't open the windows of heaven in other realms or for other reasons. Though certainly here he's specifically making a challenge that he should lie. God is here challenging you in a very specific way. He's almost saying to you, come on over to the other side. It's not like, take a chance, you might win. God is saying, do this act, and I will do everything within my power to open that window of heaven and over to the other side. He cares for you. He wants to see you blessed fully, living in a very prosperous realm. And he's challenging you in a way that will enhance that mechanism to occur. How we walk under an open window of heaven, and how we also put limits on God because of where we are. To capture this more definitively, I want to look at some scriptures where the open windows of heaven are alluded to. And it's peculiar that here in Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, where God makes this challenge for you to prove him with your tithes and your offerings, if he'll not pour you out blessings from an open window of heaven, that you will not have room enough to receive it. In Genesis, the first book of the Old Testament, is where God actually speaks first of the open window of heaven. And we're going to look at this in Genesis chapter 7, verse. But we probably will just start a little bit higher up. Genesis 7, verse 11. We're going to start from the verse 7. And Noah went in, and his sons, and his wife, and his sons' wives with him, into the ark, because of the waters of the flood, of clean beasts and of beasts that are not clean, and of fowls and of everything that creepeth upon the earth. There went in two and two unto Noah into the ark, the male and the female, as God had commanded Noah. Noah was a special child. I recently had opportunity to read some literature that said that when Noah was born to, I believe his father's name was Lamech. Lamech was so perplexed when he saw Noah, because Noah was of a figure that Lamech's question was whether this was his child or whether this was of humans. It's a diversion, but I found it so intriguing that and it bear witness with some of the scriptures and also gives a historical background on Noah, who probably we never realized his father was Lamech. But they said that Noah's eyes were so bright that when he opened them, they lit up the whole room. They said his hair was so white, it was whiter than snow. In fact, Lamech's question that he had to go to his father, Methuselah, was he wanted to know whether this was his child or not, because this child didn't seem as if from mortal. Methuselah, why he went to Methuselah is because he knew that Methuselah could get in touch with Enoch, who was Methuselah's father. somehow I think that this was a time when Enoch walked with God. You know, Enoch is just one of the few Bible characters that never physically died on the earth. And sure enough, Methuselah went and somehow was able to speak to Enoch, who informed him, yes, Noah was the child of Lamech, and that, yes, Noah was born for a special reason. You know, oftentimes in scriptures, which we're not going to get into, there are types of Christ, types of redeemers, types of people, of deliverers, types of saviors. And when we see it in this light, maybe we'll start seeing Noah even in this aspect too. But that's not the realm that I really want to get into. It's just a matter of historical perspective. Certainly, Noah was a very unusual man. He listened to the voice of the God. And he certainly built an ark in a time when there had never been rainfall on the earth. But in obedience to God, I think the cornerstone of Christian living, Noah went ahead and built this ark. And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were up on the earth. Certainly was more than 7 days. Rain had never fallen before. Noah had spent probably 120 years building the ark, and he was telling people about it. And it wasn't that, oftentimes I used to think that there was suddenly this great outburst of rain and there was a big flood on the earth and nobody had a chance to do anything. But my Bible is telling me that yes, people had a chance to do something. Certainly rain was falling for a time and the waters were getting more rapid. The waters were getting more heavy. You know, the flood was building surely, I wouldn't say slowly, but surely was building. And these are people who had opportunity to come and talk to Noah, I'm sure, because they are the same people who were screaming for his help when the door of the ark was shut. Why I say this is because the Bible is everlasting. It's from generation to generation. It is alive. Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And in generation to generation, and as we go on, it seems to get more worse. But there is an ark. There is a covenant that's available to people. And even in the scene of great turmoil, there is always that avenue, but there also comes a time when the doors are shut. And then in verse 11, where we're going to talk about the open windows of heaven, of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened.
With many regrets and no real alternatives, Noah reluctantly closed the door to the great ark. The people continued to mock Noah, unaware of the devastation and death that lie ahead.
May be the start of it.
Beyond anything they could have imagined. Their scorn was forgotten as their concern turned to fear. Even among the eight on board, uncertainty was growing.
We can't allow them to perish. Certainly we have enough provisions to bring those poor souls on board.
You know how I wish we could do what you're saying. But there's some bigger purpose, some bigger plan we're all part of. It's not in our hands to change that.
Noah's heart went out to them, but he knew he had no choice but to follow God's commands. Because of the sort of man he was, Noah's heart went out to them, but he knew he had no choice but to follow God's commands.
My. The windows of heaven were open. All the waters from the deep were set loose. What I want to say is that even in this earth, there are people who know of God, who say they believe in God, who say they trust in God, and yet still they will not prove Him with their tithes and the offerings, and oftentimes they will not prove Him with the tithes and the offerings because sin is at the doorstep. In their own consciousness, they know that sin is at the doorstep. It stops them from proving God. Because I see it like the aspect of receiving communion. People know of God, they believe in God, they trust in God, and yet still they know that it can be condemnation to their souls and their spirits should they go and have communion and know that there's sin at the doorsteps. And it limits them. Some might even go as far as to go through the physical motions. But their own consciousness, their own spiritual perspectives keeps a wall around them where they are not fully able to taste of that bread, of fiber by fiber, to experience that blood even as they symbolically drink the wine. So sometimes we do go in fear and trembling when we even take supper, and it's only because of the grace of God, and oftentimes we come to a place of repentance before we walk up on this holy ground, pass through this holy communion, that we are able to physically partake of it. And still, because of, let's call it, dark consciences, we still have a limiting wall that's created by us because of conscience, because of sin that was at the door, because we're not able to experience and realize the full forgiving power of God that sets us free. We still have that self-same doubt that all is forgiven, that we are clean, that we are spotless. And it's just a carnal nature that man has that does this to him. It's the same way with the tithes and the offerings. There are many who are afraid to trust God. They are afraid to step out. They look at what they have that is tangible and can't trust the great mighty God to give them that 30-fold, that 60-fold, that 100-fold, that great God the Creator to substantiate their lives with health, with blessings, with protection. His ways are way above our ways. 3% and 4% the bank offers, so ridiculous. But yet, there are many, even here today, that trust in their riches, that trust in their pennies, that trust in their farthings, just simply because it's tangible. We know. There are some of us that know. There are some of us that feel that we can't prove God because we have sin at the door. We can't even dare to expect the open windows of heaven, lest we be drowned in the flood. You see, when the rains fall, when the heavens open, you have to be in a covenant. You have to be in the protection. You have to be in the ark to withstand the open windows of heaven. It certainly protects you from all the screaming, from all the wailing, from all the horrors that are out there. I'm inviting you to think on the open windows of heaven. There is one man who made a comment, and he in 2 Kings, I have it marked in my Bible here. We look like we're on chapter 7 again. 2 Kings chapter 7. This was a time when there was great starvation in, I think it was Samaria. And things had become so awful that just in the chapter before, one lady was appealing to the king because she said, "Oh king, this other lady and I agreed. We were so hungry that today we would kill my son and boil him and eat him. And we did. But she agreed that tomorrow we would kill her son, and now she has hidden him." And when the king heard this, his soul travailed. He rent his clothes. I think he put on sackcloth and rubbed on ashes, which apparently was the day's order of the most humbling experience that men could have. And you could think about it. I don't know if you'd want to try it. But sackcloth, we're not thinking about nice, clean sackcloth. We're just thinking about, I don't know about you who know flour and cornmeal. Let's think of a flour and a cornmeal bag, and it's powdery. And we're going to put that on, and we're going to get ashes and make ourselves of no repute. But there's a man who made a comment, and he died in the realization of the truth. Even as many who hear my voice are going to die in the realization of the truth. Not because they didn't have opportunity, not because they didn't have not because they hadn't been ministered to, not because good sense was not knocking at the door, not because there was more than enough opportunity, more than enough signs, more than enough building of the floods to stir them on, to run to the covenant, to run to the ark, to run to the Redeemer, to run to the Deliverer. But they hardened their hearts and stiff-necked themselves and died knowing the truth, screamed knowing their opportunities were many, died, drowned, horrendous death, simply because of stiff-necked fools, I would say. And this guy, in verse 2 says, then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered, well, let me start from verse 1. The word of the Lord. Noah was telling them 120 years. Elijah says, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be? And he said, Elijah said, behold, with thine eyes, but shall not eat thereof. And verse 19 of that same chapter 7, 2 Kings, that you know the end of that man. And that lord answered the man of God and said, no, behold, if the Lord should make windows in heaven, might such a thing be? And he said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shalt not eat thereof. And so it fell out unto him, for the people trod upon him in the gate, and he died. This man couldn't believe. This man questioned God. He had the audacity, the stupidity, to say, behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, could this thing be? There's no limit on God.
Thank you. say it one more time.
I am a witness. I am a witness. Ooh. Tell you one more time.
Jesus is Lord, and he's worthy.